Welcome to today's episode of MK Alpha Mavens, presented by MK Investment Managers and PMS AIF World. I'm Sankalp from PMS AIF World, and I take care of business development here. We hope all of you are keeping safe. And today's topic is something very close to our hearts, and I think people, you know, have encountered this conundrum at some point in time. So we're going to discuss how you know, large banks are driving the wealth management business or the wealth management game in the digital age. So we're not going to restrict ourselves to just you know, these few words. It's going to be a little bit more broader in the discussion. And with that in mind, I'll introduce my guests. So you know, on the bottom right corner is Mr. Apurva Sahijawani. So he heads private banking at you know, Axis Bank. Here he's the executive vice president there. He's got you know, a couple of decades of experience. He's worked with marquee banks like Citibank, HSBC, and Kotak Wealth Management, and has been heading the private banking business at Axis Bank. So I think he'll be the perfect person to take on you know, questions or discussions you know, directing wealth management in a bank and the way forward. Along with you know, Apurva, our dear friends Vikas and Sachin. Vikas, as you all know, you know, is a veteran in the asset management business. He has almost close to two decades of experience. He's been a part of various committees from SEBI, AMFI, and he's also you know, headed marquee names like Enam, Enam Edelweiss Asset Management, and right now in his latest stint, he is the CEO at MK Investment Advisors. Accompanying him is Sachin, the fund manager at MK Investment Advisors. He is, you know, he's been a fund manager and a portfolio manager for very long and has seen a lot of cycles, and that has helped him develop his proprietary Equal system of identifying good corporate governance and quality management. And the last introduction for today is of FinLearn Academy, who are sponsoring our best question prize. So Apurva, we have this with every episode. The best question gets an award from FinLearn, which is essentially a training platform for you know, stock markets and everything equities. So it's an interesting you know, prize up for grabs. So keep sending us your questions. And before I give the floor to Vikas, let me just put this across. So I asked this question on the poll. I have investment relations with my bank, and an astounding 65% do. So you know, today you as a representative of that community are here, you know, and the audience will ask you some questions, and you have a job to, you know, do. And I think Vikas and Sachin will ask excellent questions. So over to you, Vikas.
Thank you, Sankalp. I think one of the participants, stakeholders you forgot to introduce was PMS AIF World. So let me have the privilege of doing that. I think it's a premier platform. I think I quite enjoy the content which is put up by PMS AIF World. And, you know, one of the things I keep telling my team is, each weekend, you should at least listen to one episode. There are fabulous episodes by fund managers, by people from various walks of life. So my compliments to you and your team. So let's start off. You know, I'd like to introduce Apurva at a personal level. You know, I normally do this. I talk about the guest to a lot of people. And what struck me when I started talking about Apurva is that there's so much of respect for him. You know, people have such nice things to say about him. And I've just jotted down a few. Apurva, some of these might surprise you. But trust me, this is more of people telling me rather than me getting to be a Sherlock Holmes, if you will. So I think what I've heard about you is you're full of life. You're always curious about things. And that's an amazing ability, which I can also vouch for. You're a stickler for time management. You're always 2 to 3 minutes early for all commitments, and you hate things when timings overrun. One of your favorites is your green tea or your kahwa. You love your green tea. I think your colleagues say this with, you know, both awe and trepidation, that you have the memory of an elephant. You remember numbers to their decimal points. And I can tell you most colleagues don't really like that when you recite numbers by the decimal points. Well, you're a true foodie at heart.
Apparently, that should be fairly obvious.
You know any and every good food joint south of Mumbai. You know, if somebody needs a recommendation, they don't need to go to Google. They can just talk to you, and you can just tell them exactly where to go. And the amazing part is, as much as you are a good true foodie, you also manage to watch your weight by watching the proportions you eat, and people admire that about you. Normally, you're very composed, but I've been told that if you want to see, you know, Anupam riled, you should do something to his car or talk something negative about his car. He loves his car. Not just his car, but he loves cars in general, Japanese and German in particular. Not just that, he loves movies about cars. He's seen the entire Fast and Furious series. He's a Marvel Universe super buff. He doesn't miss a single movie or TV series, primarily with his daughter. Just converse to his love for watching fictional movies. He loves non-fictional books, mostly investment related. Talking about books, I think he's got precocious talent in-house. His daughter Aditi has just co-written a book, which I believe has just been released on Amazon. Am I right, Apurva? Would you like to talk about that?
This is actually the second book she and her friends have co-authored during the pandemic. It's just been launched on Amazon, and it's actually a compilation of short stories, but quite nicely written, even if I say so myself.
Wonderful. Let me tell you, I've downloaded the book and I'm going to read that. I love reading stuff like that. Children are so talented nowadays. So let's start off with the session, Apurva. And, I just like to hark back memory lane. You've pretty much seen the wealth management business evolve, you know, from its more what is now seen as a traditional era, which was more human touch dominated, to the current digital era. I'd like to start this session by sharing your insights on this evolution.
First of all, let me thank you, Vikas, Sankalpo, Sachin. It's a pleasure to be with you today. I've been a huge admirer of the MK Alpha Mavens series. And, I've probably watched all the episodes that have come out so far. I think it's an amazing effort that you do every month. And it's great to be on the other side of the screen today and converse with you. It's something which I'm looking forward to. Thank you once again for the opportunity. Coming back to the question, Vikas, I started working in the 1990s. And I think the evolution that we've seen over the last now 23 years or so that I've been working has been actually quite remarkable. It's interesting, but I'm quite amused when I say this, because back in the 1990s, when you had to go and risk profile your clients, there was only one thumb rule: 100 minus the client's age would go into equity.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, you'll remember that, right?
Yes.
When I look back, I'm so amused because, this clearly means that two people, irrespective of their financial position, irrespective of their risk preferences, irrespective of their liquidity requirements, you would give them the same asset allocation. You would give them the same investment portfolio, right? I mean, which clearly means that the only determinant of the client's risk profile and the asset allocation was the client's age. Today, let's fast forward to today. Today, you look at investment profilers which do everything from simulate a possible risk return profile of portfolios and ask the client to choose the portfolio that he or she identifies with the best, to doing some psychometric tests and trying to figure out whether the client is risk tolerant or otherwise. I think the way we look at profiling our clients has evolved in such a remarkable manner. Let's talk about the way we used to do transactions, right? I mean, I remember back then, if you had to transact for a client, the only way to do this was on an application form, right? You would take the application form, you would attach copies of the KYC documents, and God help you if the client was a body corporate, right?
Yeah.
Then you would have your memorandum, articles, board resolution, list of authorized signatories, and the whole gamut, So getting transactions done used to be, nothing short of a nightmare. Today, getting transactions processed is as simple as the click of a button, right? For a bank like us, we have an internet banking platform, a mobile banking platform. We can do transactions on email authorization from clients. I think the seamlessness that we have seen in terms of transaction processing has changed remarkably. Let's look at one more element, which is in terms of portfolio analytics. Right? Back then, the amount of time that you would spend in terms of looking at a portfolio, and to be fair, even the portfolio by itself, the only metric that you would look at was return. So as long as the portfolio was in positive territory, well, job well done. Then, you kind of evolved to starting, looking at benchmarks. You would start benchmarking your client's portfolio to, let's say, either an index or a synthetic index. Today, the way you have the ability to analyze portfolios, not just on the return metrics, but also on risk, I think is remarkable. So I think we've really come a long way. The evolution over the last two decades or so has been quite remarkable. But I think what's going to be most exciting is what the future holds. And I think that's something to really look out for.
Interesting. You know, you actually took me back memory lane as well. And we thought we had it tough. And we look at it from your perspective. I think as wealth managers, you probably had it tougher than us. Multitude of products and all of that. In fact, you mentioned something about the future. And that brings me to my next question. You know, in India today, where specialized digital firms and what are now traditional firms, both are gaining market share. I mean, the market is so big that both are gaining market share. Where do wealth management platforms of large banks like Axis fit into this entire paradigm? You know, I mean, yeah, please.
Vikas, Apurva, before you begin that answer, let me just give you this very interesting poll that I ran, okay? So I ran my relationship with my bank is because of amongst all the options, okay, 44% of the respondents today say because of convenience, okay, and then the next majority feels that because of technology. So these are probably on, if we you know, count today's audience to be representative of the average investor or average consumer. So this is where the demographic is distributed along. So, you know, before you venture into that answer of digital wealth management, I thought, you know, I'll give you this perspective. Over to you, sir.
No, actually, that's a very remarkable insight. And I would have thought that, you know, the number would have been more like 50%, and there you are. But it's interesting. I think Vikas probably has got logged off, but let me start.
Yeah,
let me just kind of attempt to answer the question that Vikas mentioned. See, I started working in the 1990s, right? And if you go back to the 1990s, wealth management was largely the domain of brokerage houses, right? At that point in time, it was largely in terms of your capabilities on transactional side or in terms of your research. So you actually saw wealth management being very synonymous with brokerage houses. Then came the first decade of the new millennium, right, where we saw foreign banks doing remarkably well. And I think that was fairly obvious considering the fact that they were able to leverage technology back then. They were able to bring in best practices from their overseas businesses. I worked with foreign banks for almost 14 years in my career. And I saw the kind of, there was a time when they were really, really ahead of their time. Then you saw the last decade where you saw the rise of NBFCs and boutique wealth management houses, you know, because of their nimbleness, their flexibility. You know, I thought they kind of pretty much captured a fair bit of market share. I firmly believe this decade will see and is perhaps already witnessing the rise of private sector banks as a dominant player in the wealth management business.
Interesting.
And the reasons are fairly obvious. I think first things first, wealth is no longer a tier one or a tier two city phenomenon. Today, you know, you see affluence in all parts of the country. Remember, Vikas, when we used to use terms like B30 and B50?
Yes.
I can't remember the last time somebody talked about, you know, B30, B50 markets. Because now you're seeing a proliferation of wealth across the country. I mean, I can tell you over the last 15 months or so, since we've been largely working from home or being, you know, or we have been using a hybrid model, the amount of interactions I've had with clients in, you know, the so-called upcountry locations has been remarkable. And these have been extremely savvy investors, right? So I think wealth is kind of now proliferating across the country. And this is where, you know, if you have a presence in that particular market, it makes a huge difference. I mean, I have reason to believe that the top four private sector banks in the country have a combined number of 17,000 branches between them.
Right.
And a large number of these are in what the RBI categorizes as semi-urban locations.
Right.
We are witnessing the rise of informed investors in markets like these. The second point is what we just alluded to, which is in terms of banks using technology to maximum effect. Today, you know, from risk profiling our clients to providing them with investment solutions, to doing seamless transactions, through internet, mobile, email, all of that, you know, is helping us really build scale, you know, in the wealth management business. And the third and most important part, and this I think clearly was symbolic of the poll that, you know, that that we just ran, which essentially talks about the convenience of having a one-stop solution provider in the form of a bank. And I think this, to my mind, is clearly paving the way for this decade to be dominated by private sector banks. I firmly see this, you know, this trend emerging in this decade, and I think the opportunity on financialization of savings is also coinciding with this. So I do believe that there is a huge runway ahead for private sector banks and especially banks like us to leverage the opportunity in wealth management.
Interesting. I think Sachin, in his part, analyzes banks for a living, and I'm sure he has a few questions for you, Sachin.
Yeah, thanks, Vikas. And Apurva, thank you so much for coming on the show. You know, just taking the discussion forward, and I really appreciate the point that you made that why banks have the right to, win this business in the next few years. I'm just trying to be a bit of a devil's advocate here, in the sense that, markets are very dynamic. The environment is very dynamic. There are always something new coming up in a very, very, the tenure of the longer duration of products is actually getting, the life of the products are getting shortened, right? Now, from that perspective, one also needs to be agile as an investor. But as an investor, I am guided by my advisor. Now, when it comes to large banks like yours, there will be some bit of, bureaucratic, which will slow down the whole pace of being agile with the investors in terms of recommendations or even creating new products compared to the new age digital or wealth, focused wealth management firms, where they could be much more, fast in terms of turnaround or in terms of recommendation of new products. How does a large bank like that compete in the markets, or not only compete, but actually be more, it makes much more purposeful from an investor's perspective?
No, that's a great question, Sachin. And if you were to look at it objectively, see, there is a large segment of what I would like to call as the do-it-yourself kind of investors, right? For whom the nimbleness, the flexibility of a digital platform or a focused wealth management platform will make a world of difference, right? But that's one side of the spectrum. The other side of the spectrum is where you have, investors who are heavily dependent upon their wealth managers to guide them through what is happening, in financial markets, do proper financial planning for them, build resilient portfolios for them. And I think there's a huge population which lies somewhere in between these two extremes, right? So I think, across the continuum, if you were to look at it, it is becoming imperative for wealth managers to use digital interventions, right? So today as a bank, it is, I think it's fairly obvious that we also leverage digital interventions extensively. I'll give an example. Till a few years ago, wealth managers used to spend a disproportionate amount of time to prepare client portfolio reviews, right? I remember doing this extensively, right? Where you would assimilate data, you would compile performance reports, you would track key ratios, then you would get down to the recommendations part of it, right? Today, the first three steps have been automated, right? This is leaving you so much time focus on the recommendation part, and the quality of your client engagement has actually become richer. So at Axis Bank, we've invested very heavily in technology. This is allowing us to look at portfolio performance. This is allowing us to look at the key analytics in our client portfolios. And this leaves us adequate time for client engagement, taking rebalancing calls and so on and so forth. So I think, honestly, there will be a hybrid model, and which to my mind is clearly what we are witnessing the emergence of, where your client engagement is in person, right? That may not necessarily be completely digital, and it could be virtual, like the way we are conversing right now. But your reporting, your analytics and all are digitized. So I think today as a bank, we see us using this hybrid model very extensively. I hope that answers your question.
Yes, and now I have a related to that, and I'm very curious because it actually directly impacts me, but I'm sure it's also important for all the investors. So, you mentioned something very interesting, that because of technology, you have more time to focus on what you would like to recommend, right? In terms of the recommendations or the portfolio strategy for the investor. So, when you recommend, obviously you will recommend a few investment products. Now, typically, whenever you are recommending an investment product, you would have already done some analysis on that product, and then you would have onboarded those products. So what I would like to know, though, is that what is that method in that madness? On what basis do you approve that product? What will it take for MK investment managers to be on Axis Bank's plate?
So you're asking for our secret sauce then?
Your investors would also like to know what hard work you put in there, right?
No, sure. See, at Axis Bank, we follow an open architecture model. And while it is an open architecture model, I think what is important for us is to formulate our house views, right, across asset classes. Now, we've created a very strong investment committee, and we meet every month. We take the insights, our insights from that investment committee's recommendations. helping us form a house view across asset classes. Then we scope the market to identify those investment products which are in sync with these views. Of course, that's the first phase of the process. Once we identify these products, we then start engaging with the investment managers to understand their investment philosophy, their rationale, their approach. We then get into a detailed due diligence. We look at the track record. We look at risk-adjusted returns. We look at peer set comparison. And also, importantly, very importantly, understand the qualitative aspects behind the making of their performance. And once that entire process is completed, and you know, let's assume that the outcome is favorable, we then onboard the product. And we get our teams, our frontline teams, to interact with the investment manager, you know, essentially kind of train them on the nuances of the product so that they can then have meaningful engagement with their clients. But, you know, it doesn't stop there. The process doesn't stop here. In fact, we continue to engage with the investment manager. We track the performance. We look at, you know, continuing to see how they have done vis-a-vis benchmark, vis-a-vis industry peers. And, you know, I think this is done largely to see whether the hypothesis holds true or not. This actually, you know, this very meticulous, this very, you know, nuanced process has helped us avoid a lot of accidents along the way. And this is something which we'll continue to practice. So I hope, you know, my secret sauce is now available for you, Sachin.
Sure. Thank you. Thank you, Apurva. Really helpful. Thank you.
You see, the thing about secret sauce is, you know, it's like that Warren Buffett has always said that this is the way I invest. Please go and copy me, but people can't. I think the secret sauce is not sharing this, but in executing this, which I'm sure it's quite rigorous at your end, which is what explains the, you know, the success of products recommended at your end.
No, and here I'd like to compliment our extensive research team, because I think they've done, they do this day in and day out. And, you know, I think it's not an easy job, but they continue to do it remarkably well.
I agree with you. It's not an easy job at all. In fact, I just want to ask you a very basic question now, because this has been coming to me from, you know, I asked on Twitter, please direct message me any question which you have. So one question which came to me, and I was stumped by the simplicity of it.
Sure.
And I wanted to give a very different answer, but I'm asking you, what, according to you, is the difference between wealth management and private banking?
Oh, this is a personal favorite, this question.
Oh, is it? Okay.
You know, I get asked this question many times by clients mostly. And I always have a standard answer. This is my interpretation. So, you know, you may not see this in a textbook, but I firmly believe that wealth management looks at only the asset side of a client's balance sheet, while private banking looks at the balance sheet in entirety.
Interesting.
Let me elaborate. You know, by this logic, wealth management is essentially a subset of private banking. Now, okay. You know, you may have instances where your clients today have money to invest, right? Mm-hmm. And you come in as a wealth manager. But there is a possibility that tomorrow they may be in need of money. The question is, how well can you do that job? And that's where at Axis Bank, we believe our position as a bank allows us to look at our client's balance sheet and take a holistic view of what their financial needs are. See, this is where we can leverage our sharp understanding of wealth management and banking. And we can provide solutions which are, you know, relevant for both sides of the client's balance sheet. So we go beyond the conventional wealth management solutions, and that's how we deal with our private banking clients. I hope that answers.
No, that's wonderful. I think that gives me a lot of clarity. You know, one of the other questions I just wanted to ask you is, it is generally believed that it is easier for banks to acquire customers, you know, because of the network. How much of truth is there in this statement? Is it easier for you, or actually is there a little bit more pressure on you because you have customers and you have to, you know, have a sort of framework to live up to?
No, it's an interesting notion, but I'd like to challenge that notion, Vikas. See, just because we are a bank and a large bank, it doesn't mean clients will necessarily relate to us as wealth managers. We need to earn that, you know, that position. We need to work hard to build a parallel or a symbiotic relationship in the minds of our clients as both their banker and their wealth manager. See, this is where our ability to blend our research, you know, generate those house views which I was referring to, our ability to leverage our technology, our ability to identify trends in the economy, you know, and certain, let's say, proactive decisions that we can take. All of this, essentially, there has to be a proof of concept. And only then will clients start entrusting us with the responsibility of also managing their wealth. So it's not easy, but it is an achievable task. You know, to acquire customers for us. You know, for us, and the logical thought is quite clearly, and this is what our leadership has been asking us to do, is to try and be both the primary banker and the primary wealth manager for our clients. Now, this, if you ask me, kind of really puts in perspective the fact that, you know, you may have a bank customer, but the bank customer may not necessarily be a wealth management customer. So, you know, I'd like to challenge that notion that it's very easy for us. It is a tough job, but I think we do it quite well.
I would tend to agree, because as an individual, for example, I have I bank with two private sector banks, and both the wealth management firms, you know, are in touch with me. It is actually difficult for them to justify their products to me, rather than it's difficult for me. So I think the onus is quite a lot on the private sector banks to justify that. I completely agree with you. Which actually brings me to the next question. You know, the point of interface with the client is usually the relationship manager. And again, there is this general belief that a lot of RMs keep shuffling in the banking network. It may not necessarily be in the private banking space, but it is probably the personal banking space or the consumer banking space. From your perspective, how do you think banks can check this and add to customer experience? You know, what is the life cycle of... sorry, Apurva, did you hear the question? You want me to repeat?
Because there was a bit of an outage. If you wouldn't mind repeating that, please.
Sure. So I was saying that the moment of truth for a banker, for a bank, is when the relationship manager, I think he's having a problem with his... just wait for him to join back again. I think these are the perils of work from home, I guess.
Yeah. What I was saying is, I'm seeing a lot of interesting questions coming for Apurva.
Because I'm back, sorry about this, but I think there was a bit of an outage at mine.
No problem. An outage is always preferable. The last time I was doing a session, there were crows in the background, you know, when I was talking, which got very embarrassing. So I think an outage is still preferable.
Last question you were asking was?
Yeah, I'll repeat my question again. I think what I was saying is that the moment of truth for any bank is when you interact with the customer through an RM. And by virtue of the fact that RMs keep shuffling and reshuffling, how does a bank like yours check this and, you know, make sure that the customer experience is consistent? That was a question.
Sure. No, look, I'll admit that I think, you know, the banking industry has seen a lot of RM attrition. But I think that the key here is to look at how you can give a clear career path to somebody who wants to do wealth management as a long-term career option. Right. I'll give an example. We have now more than 100 private bankers, you know, in Burgundy Private, the business that I lead. And I'm happy to share with you that more than 40% of them are homegrown talent. Right. And these are people who have joined us, some of them dating back to as long as 15 years.
Interesting.
And, you know, the best part is that if you look at the way they have evolved, they started off typically managing, in fact, in some cases, even managing client servicing requirements, in some cases as what we call as our priority relationship managers. Over a period of time, they kind of gravitated to becoming Burgundy relationship managers and eventually moved into the private bank. And I think this is quite clearly now becoming a clear career choice for people who are very serious about wealth. So if you look at the journey, you know, it also in a way kind of coincides with your client's life cycle, doesn't it? Because at some stage, you know, you acquire a client at the early stage, and the client typically, a lot of our clients, with the exception of maybe second or third generation entrepreneurs, would typically have been business people, professionals, executives. You know, they would have also started off early in their careers. They would have earned wealth the hard way. They would have kind of grown to an extent where they become high or ultra high net worth clients, and their needs would have evolved. Now imagine a symbiotic relationship where your wealth manager is also growing, you know, upskilling herself, you know, building new skills, and over a period of time is in a position to meet those requirements that you already have. So for us, I think as, you know, as a journey, this makes a lot of sense. So we are kind of clearly working towards a model where the wealth manager continues to manage that relationship over a period of time, right? Even though the client's requirements may kind of evolve, may become a little more nuanced. And I think this, in a way, also helps the wealth manager progress through the organization's ranks, progress across the different segments that get the private banking business, which pretty much is the epitome of the entire pyramid. And there you continue to manage clients. In fact, I have a very interesting take on this. I keep telling my private bankers that your true test is over a period of time, how do you reduce the number of clients and increase your assets under management, Right.
Interesting.
Yeah, that to my mind is actually clearly symbolic of the journey for a private bank. So that's our way of looking at it. And to my mind, if you continue to invest in you know your team, you know you give them the right kind of interventions, you train them, you know help them kind of acquire and engage with large quality clients. There is no reason why you will face the attrition issues which some of our competition continues to face.
Interesting. That's very interesting. Sachin?
Yeah, so Apurva, this is very interesting because, you know, you mentioned about the evolving in terms of the client side, how they keep on growing bigger, and that helps the relationship manager also to, you know, it makes a lot of sense to stick with them. But taking a different perspective now that, you know, we have also seen that in terms of wealth management, things have been evolving. Like, as you said, you know, if you go back to the 90s, it was only probably equities. Then it was probably to some extent debt funds and balanced funds. There was an era where people also looked at, you know, then it was real estate, then art, right? Now we are in a digital age. Now we're talking about cryptocurrencies. So where are we headed in terms of the evolvement of the wealth management in terms of the asset classes?
No, actually, that's a question which we keep asking ourselves, you know, in terms of how is the business evolving? How are we moving forward? See, I think there will be significant opportunities for wealth managers. In fact, you know, newer asset classes are coming in. And the good part is that a lot of our clients are also now cultivating that level of interest, you know, that level of knowledge. So today, when we go to our clients with ideas like venture debt or private equity, you know, they're absolutely open to these kind of newer, relatively newer asset classes, right? Or in some cases, you know, there are sub asset classes which have got created. And, you know, clients are absolutely fine with that. But I think that the true evolution is happening, you know, in the new economy space, whether it is, you know, newer sets of companies, you know, which are coming in, whether it is, you know, newer technologies which are coming out. You know, of course, there are newer asset classes also, like you said, you know, crypto, NFTs, all of these are coming in. But I think to a large extent, the younger generation of our clients are now keeping a close watch on you know, newer asset classes like these. To us, I think we want to be, you know, true to label. We are a bank, you know, we are bred on an ethos of conservatism. So we want to kind of be very cautious about how we want to look at some of these newer asset classes. Having said which, never said never, at some stage we will venture into, you know, into this space. But I think we will probably want to wait to see how they, you know, how the depth into these asset classes increases, how the regulation in these asset classes increases. And over a period of time, then start blending ideas like these, you know, into our client portfolios.
Okay. But, you know, when we look at the global scenario where a lot of these wealth firms, you know, are there, I mean, there are, all the global banks have their wealth management or the, you know, private banking space. How do you think has the Indian advisory space evolved in comparison to the global standards?
I think we've evolved particularly well over the course of the last few years. If you ask me, I think the curve has become much sharper in the last few years. Of course, I think regulatorily, you know, we've kind of moved in the right direction. So today, you know, investor protection is becoming a very, very important point. And I think that's, you know, that's absolutely necessary for a large economy like ours. Investor awareness has gone up very sharply. And I think that's a big positive because to me, it clearly goes to show that now, you know, your client is equally participating, you know, in terms of the investment decision, in terms of the entire financial plan. The other good part is the fact that in a way, it kind of puts the onus on the wealth manager to keep herself updated, right? To keep investing in yourself, to keep making sure that, you know, over a period of time, you increase your knowledge, your skill sets, your capabilities, and are able to service the requirements of your clients. I think when you benchmark it to global practices, we may not be completely there, but I think we are clearly getting there. So like I said, I think regulation, processes, technology, of course, is very much there. That is one good part. I don't see a huge gap that exists between the way wealth management services are offered globally and the way you know they are offered here. Over a period of time, I've had the good opportunity to engage with some of these, let's say some of our counterparts in different markets. And honestly, when you speak with them, deep down you realize that there really isn't too much of a difference between the way they look at clients and manage their wealth and we do the same thing.
Apurva, let me reverse this question. Okay. do you think the investors or your clients have also evolved and matured like the global investors? Like, you know, where I'm coming from is that today, you know, a lot of us would meet investors or our clients. They probably only look at what are the best returns. Nobody thinks about the risk-adjusted returns and those kind of things. Whereas if you think about it from a global, whenever I meet a large, you know, NRI client or even a global investor,
sure,
they all are very, very mature enough in terms of understanding what is the return expectations, what is the return output in the context of the risk. And they, you know, sometimes I feel that they are very clear that, you know, I want to earn so much extra over the risk-free, or why am I not earning so much extra over the risk-free? Do we see that maturity coming in the investor side in India?
No, actually, it's a great point, Sachin, and I think it is. I think it is because, you know, it's also a function of recent events. Let's take an example. Let's look at fixed income as an asset class. Right? I mean, conventionally, the notion was that fixed income will give you capital protection, will give you some level of predictable returns. Right? Clearly, events over the last 2.5-3 years have shattered that myth completely. And today, you know, clients are very cognizant about where in fixed income they're investing. And I think it's an outcome of the events that we've seen in the recent past. So today, you know, we have instances where clients are actually clear about the fact that on the fixed income side of their portfolio, they will have a certain tolerance, you know, up to a certain rating, not beyond that. Interest rate risk, another issue that, you know, people have seen in the fixed income space, right? Interest rate cycles are becoming much shorter as compared to what we've seen in the past. You know, having seen a spate of, you know, interest rate cuts and having seen, you know, this huge gush of liquidity, today when we talk to clients, they are worried about the fact that what happens to our portfolios when you know, yields start going up, right? Or when there are interest rate hikes. So I think, you know, there is a certain amount of evolution that we've seen in investors as well. It may not have happened across the pyramid, but I think clearly from the top to the middle of the pyramid, we can see it happen. And it is good. I think it's a very timely thing. You know, whether it, you know, this pertains to events like what we saw back in 2007, 2008 during the times of the global financial crisis, or whether it was going back to 2000, 2001 when the technology crash happened. I think people who have been scarred in instances like these today have still, they have retained those learnings. And in most instances today, at least the segment of clients that we interact with, we see a lot of focus on not just the returns, but also the risk part of the portfolio. Yeah, it does.
Yeah, fantastic. So I understand and I agree with you, because I remember that if you go back to the 2008-9 days, the CEO of the largest mutual fund said that, you know, the Indian investors believe that the default risk is always with the AMC. But, you know, coming to 2018-19, I think that has changed. This time the AMCs could not take that risk, at least a couple of them which have gone far. So I'm sure the investors have learned their lesson by now, and that maturity is evolving. You're right. Yeah.
Wonderful. You know, I'm so tempted to ask you a few more questions, but what I'm seeing is that the chat box is getting flooded with questions. So I'm going to hold my questions right now, and I'm just going to go straight to the chat box. But before that, Sankalpo, anything you have on your polls?
I'm asking a couple of polls. So one interesting poll that I ran was, I just took a photo. I'll just read it out. Yeah. So my investment RM has been with me for, okay. So the options were less than a year, 1 to 3 year, and 3 to 5 years, and 5 year plus. So Apurva, any guesses where the bulk of the relationship vintage has been with, you know, with the RM vintage has been?
No, I'll bite. I think it will probably be erring on the lower end of the spectrum.
Yeah, you're right. It's 1 to 3 years is where the 44% of the respondents feel that, you know, say that their relationship with their RM has been. So
next time you ask the name of the bank, it'll change.
that'll be of much interest, I can assure you.
So we'll run that as the next poll. So we'll take a few questions, and I'm just typing out a couple of other polls. Also, we'll keep them and we'll keep coming back to those in between.
Apurva, I must tell you that these questions are not just interesting, but they're actually detailed. This is the first time I'm seeing such detailed questions coming to me. So
very pointed questions, very focused.
Very, very pointed and very detailed questions. So that's why I'm just jettisoning some of my questions. I'm going straight there. One of the questions says that, you know, you earlier mentioned that wealth managers were with broking outfits, and only over the last few years they've been carved out as a separate vertical. This is a question from Kashyap Javeri. He says, how do we see the current setup being challenged when some brokers are again disrupting this with AI or machine learning?
No, actually, that's a great observation. I think we are seeing the AI ML impact coming in. But, you know, I think look at the applicability of AI and ML. Today, I think within the equity asset class, you know, it has a fair bit of relevance, which means that, you know, the application of AI ML will typically come in, you know, in a specific category, a specific asset class. But as a wealth manager, aren't you required to have overview across all asset classes? Aren't you required to build, strong, resilient, and fairly stable portfolios? Which means there will be instances for you to use applications like these, but they may still be confined to a limited part of your client's portfolios. Today, we've seen the rise of alternate assets, but I don't think, you know, as a wealth manager, we can afford to build a portfolio which comprises entirely of alternate assets. I mean, there will be an allocation to alternate assets, but, you know, it could be 5, 10, 15, 25%. But the core of your portfolio will still comprise your regular equity and fixed income options in most instances. Having said which, I think as wealth managers, all of us need to be open to, instances like these. And I see, now practically with a much higher level of frequency, established long-only fund houses coming to us with strategies which are, heavily dependent upon AI and ML interventions. So, yeah, I think it's a great point, but to my mind, it will still have, at least for some time, limited applicability.
Interesting. There was this question by Abdul Riaz, which I'm unable to find it right now, but I got the gist of it, and I'm just giving you the gist of it. Is there a feedback monitoring or measurement mechanism which you have where you can monitor the feedback from clients on the advice which has been tendered to them, as well as the RM's capability when he's tendering the advice? Do you have a feedback monitoring mechanism at your end?
Yes, actually we do. We do we use NPS very extensively to try and understand what the client experience of our wealth managers has been. Of course, we have regular, surveys which we do across the board. Did one as recent as I think third quarter of last year, and we look through these very minutely. And the good part is that in some of these surveys, we actually even ask clients to give qualitative feedback, okay. And that feedback gets channelized. And of course, I must confess, I think some of that qualitative feedback is fairly pointed, and some of that qualitative feedback kind of complements people who've been fairly, I think thorough in terms of the way they've been engaging with clients. So I think it's a natural thing, especially when you're catering to clients who are very sensitive, very large. It's only imperative that you have, these kind of feedback mechanisms in place. But it's a great question. And I think as, as a private bank, we continue to seek this feedback on a proactive basis from our clients.
Super. That's amazing. Like they say, feedback is the fuel for champions, right? So I think Absolutely. You're building a race of champion advisors. Amazing. Hasid Jagat Sheth asks a question here. What all should I look in before I decide my private banker? This before somebody wants to be my private banker. Yeah, and I think that's pretty universal in its nature.
No, I think it's a great question, especially coming from somebody who's a seasoned investor. I think what's relevant is of course the fact that you should see how it complements you. So let's say today we come to an investor who has been kind of managing her portfolio on her own. Over a period of time, there is a fair bit of, selection bias which tends to come in, right? You tend to kind of, if a strategy has worked well for you, you tend to kind of do that same line. As a wealth manager, can I come in and complement that in some shape and form? I think that's particularly important. And if you can bring in, complementary, interventions, whether it is in the form of products, whether it is in the form of a process, I think that is something which you should look for. Of course, needless to say, it's important for you to work with the right set of people. So, the organization itself, the brand, their focus, the kind of investment that they've made in the people that come in and eventually engage with you, I think that makes a lot of difference. So there is a qualitative part of it, which clearly comes in through the kind of approach that they have. And there is obviously a quantitative part of it, which is, you can look at the kind of organization it is, basis their reach, basis their network, basis the people, and basis, of course, the kind of financial stability that it offers.
Interesting. There are a couple of questions somebody's asked me on banks and capital raising and all of that. Ajay, I'm sorry, I'm going to be skipping that because this is really not relevant here. Narinder Khad says, a question to you is, you know, the tenets of a good portfolio. How do you view, you know, he's asking, considering the current economic scenario in the country, everybody thinks equity is an important one. What is your recommendation to a client in terms of other asset classes, especially foreign asset classes, especially foreign equity? This is an interesting one.
It is. And, you know, as wealth managers, we have been propagating the significance or the relevance of investing outside the country as well. You know, you are aware about what happened yesterday, I think, with the, you know, with SEBI's decision to increase the limits on you know, on the at the AMC level on feeder funds. I think this is something which was in the offing because of the fact that we are seeing a lot of interest from investors now to look at investing in offshore markets. On the one hand, of course, RBI has allowed the liberalized remittance scheme where, you know, to, let's say, $250,000 an individual, $1 million for a family of four can be remitted overseas for investments. Today, as a bank, needless to say, you know, we are not capacitized to manage that particular requirement, except for facilitating the remittance. But thanks to the fact that a lot of AMCs, including our own, have been able to bring in a lot of feeder funds, which have channelized, you know, their flows, which they've collected here in India, into, you know, good quality, resilient portfolios, we have started seeing a lot of interest in, you know, in this space. And I think one way to evaluate this is the fact that the pandemic, for instance, has impacted every single economy. But economies are on the mend, they are on the bounce back, and if this gives you the opportunity to kind of diversify your portfolio in the truest sense of the term, invest in other economies where the level of correlation with the Indian economy is low, right, where there is opportunity for you to make returns as, you know, they kind of come back on track, why not? So I think the opportunity for investing offshore is clearly coming to the fore. You know, of course, one needs to be prudent, because the bulk of your portfolio will be here in India because your consumption will be in India. I think it's a question of how much of at a portfolio level you would be comfortable allocating into an offshore market. I mean, the number could range from maybe 5% to 25%. But yes, we've started seeing a lot of interest in that particular space.
Interesting. A feedback which we've got from Rahul Chadda saying that this is yet another interesting webinar. Thank you so much, Rahul. You've been one of our regular viewers. A question which Rahul asked, and I think it's a very pointed question, and I'm going to take it in the spirit of you actually communicating. There are a lot of perceptions which people have, and I think the best way to dispel perception is through candid communication. One of the questions which keeps coming is that banks actually are only offering products that they want to push. Okay, banks normally push products which they think are relevant for them. In a way, I think if I understand Rahul's question, to some extent you have talked about your recommendation process, the way you look at products, but I just want you to dwell on this a little bit more, because a lot of people still believe that the products which they're offered by bankers, you know, in the long term may not be in their interest, may not necessarily be true about your bank, but general. So I think at a fraternity level, you'll be doing banks a favor by addressing this question.
See, honestly, I think you also have to look at it in the light of regulation. Today, as you're aware, you know, most investment products, mutual funds, PMSs, they've moved to an alt-rail model, right? Which means the element of differentiation, right, between offering product A vis-a-vis product B has reduced to a large extent. The other good thing is the fact that expense ratios are now capped, you know, by the regulator. So I think, you know, what may have happened in the past is not likely to transpire in the future. And I think you will see a lot of judicious selection by banks. I can't speak for the rest of the industry, but at least from our standpoint, I can tell you that our research team does an amazing job in terms of identifying the right set of ideas which we can take to our clients. And, you know, it's like I said earlier, the process doesn't stop at, you know, at the point of sale. You know, it kind of continues beyond. And I think what's relevant now is for the investor to have the comfort that, yes, you know, the banker is somebody who's going to help me create, you know, a long-term, stable and resilient portfolio. So it is not a one-time sale, you know, quite clearly. You will, you know, expect your bank and your banker, your wealth manager, especially, like I said, you know, if somebody is very serious about this business and wants to, over a period of time, kind of make a career, you know, in wealth management, you will be judicious about how you deal with your clients. So, you know, like I said, I can't speak on behalf of all the banks, but I can tell you that I think our approach here is especially discerning in terms of the way we identify the right set of ideas and we take them to our clients.
Thank you for answering the question, Apurva, because one of the things you mentioned earlier was feedback you get from clients on products and on RMs. I think that is a brilliant way to actually control any sort of quote-unquote mis-selling which might be happening at the ground level. If you get to hear from the client directly and on the RM, I think that is the best thing which a client can expect. I personally got a lot of comfort when I heard that. And I think the second thing which most people don't realize is that in this day and age of information explosion, where you know even the smallest of investor can get onto Twitter and start creating havoc, banks are actually under pressure to make sure that at an overall level, their brand is protected. It is not just a product that they want to stake their entire reputation on. So Rahul, I can probably tell you that when Apurva started talking about the evolution of distributors over the last 20 years, this is one thing which has really evolved. I very much doubt whether banks would probably indulge in such practices even today. There could be a few bad fish here and there, but that is there in every business. You really can't help it. But thanks for the question, Rahul. I think it really helped us clear the air in a big way. Narendra Khadse actually asks a question which is about advisory in general, wealth management in general. Which is the best methodology, a fee paid by the client or a commission paid indirectly by the client in terms of getting advisory?
See, I think it's a function of the client's preferences. Today, as a bank, we have a distribution orientation. Regulatorily, that's the model that we have chosen to follow. But today, let's say, you know, our brokerage platform, for instance, will offer advisory services for clients who are willing to pay a fee. I think the cost of managing or the cost of building a portfolio is something which is becoming more and more critical, especially as the portfolio sizes increase. So I think there will be a tipping point at which point you may have to take that call in terms of whether you want to work with a distributor or with an advisor. What is the tipping point for me will be very different as a tipping point for you, Vikas. Needless to say, I think, you know, the answer lies within. So rather than kind of advocate a particular model, I think it's more a function of at what stage would you want to kind of, evolve or rather, you know, flip the model and move to either side.
I'll take this last question, which is it's a fairly obvious question. It's a yes or no type of question. Abhimanyu asked this question in terms of the fact that SEBI regulations and para-banking guidelines, will they impact your ability to give advice? Your view?
Like I said, I did mention that we are a distributor. At the end of the day, you know, for us, advisory is something which we, through the bank, can as it is not offer. But, you know, I think there is enough that we can do on the distribution platform itself. In fact, we are among the largest mutual fund distributors in the country, next only to two other banks. And, you know, we continue to build on our assets under management. See, the good part is as you build, as you, like I said, the top four banks have 17,000 branches. Right? We are reaching out to clients across locations where they probably did not have access to investment ideas like these before or through the delivery mechanisms that we are using, which they did not have access to before. So today, even through the distribution model, we've built, I think, a formidable amount of assets and a very, very strong client connect. And that's the model that we've chosen. So be it. I think the impact is already there. But then I think in spite of which, we continue to build on this particular business.
Apurva, one thing which I'm getting in the chat across the board, which your bank might want to consider, is a lot of people are asking about cryptocurrency. I think Sachin alluded to that. Mm. So at some stage, I think, you may want to do some webinars or some educational series in terms of cryptocurrency. A lot of questions are coming on cryptocurrency.
Sure. Like I said, Vikas, never say never. You know, it is something which, you know, is writing on the wall. We will have to look at evolving and look at, addressing that particular need for our clients. But I think let's wait for some kind of, let's say, method behind the madness to emerge.
Yes, yes, yes. I think that is true. So I think I'm done in terms of the questions. And Apurva, I think if it is okay with you, the question which really got me interested was the question on feedback. I think that was something which answered a lot of the questions which were coming in later. Yes. So I think Mr. Abdul Riaz, if it's okay with you, should we give him the prize in terms of the best question
absolutely.
Of the day?
Absolutely. Yeah. By far, I think that, to my mind, was the pick of all the questions which we saw today.
Thank you so much. Abdul Riaz, you could get in touch with us or PMS AIF World, do write in. And congratulations.
Congratulations, Abdul. Yeah, so I'll just discuss this one poll that I asked while this question and answers were on. So I asked for investment needs, what do people on the show today want to associate most with? Okay, 47% said boutique family offices and independent advisors. 31% said domestic bank or domestic wealth management companies. Open platforms like PMS AIF World was a 21%. And surprisingly, none of the people today feel that they should, have the relationship with foreign investment banks or foreign banks. So, that is not my, opinion with a caveat. So that's something. I will like to thank the audience and thank Apurva and Vikas and Sachin, all of you. So, before we end the show, I will like to take a couple of minutes talking about us, about PMS AIF World, if that's okay. So, sure. We've been doing this series and a couple of other series also, which are more educational in nature. We also, work as a wealth manager and we advise a lot of families now on, alternates in the country. We've been growing and we request you to come reach to us. You can book a call with us. You can know more about these, investment strategies. Do follow and subscribe our YouTube channel where you can, hear all the other Alpha Mavens episodes too. We've had some great guests and thank you Apurva for being with us. Thank you Mr. Thank you to the audience for being with us and asking questions. Congratulations Mr. Abdul. Thank you Vikas. Thank you Sachin. We hope to see you all very soon. Thank you.
Thank you Apurva.
It's been a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot. Thank you. Bye-bye. Bye.